Your presence overwhelmed by love. to fail or forsake. Unending promise, heaven inside us, whispers the sound of your name. Holy, holy is the
y'all give it up for these kids. Wow. Way to go. I tell you what, it takes a lot of guts to stand up here in front of you guys, and these guys are doing phenomenal. They're actually going to stay up here and help us lead worship this morning, so I'm pretty stoked to be sure that, thank you for helping this morning and using the gifts that you guys, that God's given you. Well, welcome back to Fort Johnson Baptist Church. You guys are the real Christians, the ones who actually have come back after the big special day last Sunday. No, I was playing. We did have a great time, and we'll have a great time today celebrating who Jesus is and worshiping him this morning. We're a family of faith who exists to help people find and follow Jesus here at Fort Johnson Baptist Church. And my name is Marty. I'm the senior pastor here, and glad that you have taken and made this a priority, the worship of our Lord a priority. I know on a pretty day like this, it would be nice to do a thousand other things, but you have come to give Jesus honor and praise this morning. So thank you so much. If you are new with us this morning, it's your first time in the seat back in front of you, you'll see a connect card. If you'll fill that out and give it to the folks at the welcome desk, they've got a gift for you just to say thank you for joining us, allow you to get to know a little bit about what God's doing here at Fort Johnson, and allows us to get to know you a little bit better as well. We'd love to connect with you this week. Also, next Sunday is Easter Sunday, and we will have two services, one so that we can have enough room for everybody who comes in. But I know some people are like, hey, I've got lunch with my family and all that, so if you need to come to the early one, that's fine too. We do have childcare only at the 10:30 service next week as well. So if you're like, man, I don't have children, maybe you want to come to the 9 o'clock service and worship on that. If you've got children, come to the 10:30, and we'll have that childcare as well. So that's next Sunday at 9 and 10:30, and after each of those services, we'll have a kids ministry activity in the gym that is sure to be a blast for the children who are here. Also, as we prepare for Easter, this week our children's minister has put together a devotional, an Easter devotional. I think she emailed it out to a lot of the parents this week, but also she printed off some copies that are at the Welcome Center. So if you want to walk through some scripture as you prepare your heart for Easter, grab one of those as you leave today. And then a heads up as you go through, and maybe you're looking at the bulletin, a couple things I want to point out in April, because a lot of times we think Easter and then we're done, but I was trying to think, okay, what's coming up after that? Mark your calendars for April 13th and 14th. On April the 13th is a Saturday. We're going to have a serve day where we'll serve do some things here around the church, but also around our community as well, that morning from like 8 to noon. And then on the 14th, we'll have a potluck. So plan to be here for that, bring in food, we'll gather back in the fellowship hall, and just a great time to connect with one another and build relationships with one another. So I hope that you'll avail yourself of that and join us for that. Are you guys glad to be here this morning? Yeah, yeah, it is a special day, not only because we get to come and we worship the Lord, but today is also the birthday of our ministry assistant, Ashley Mims. So make sure you wish her a happy birthday, because it is today. But I'm going to ask Mr. Derek Davis, who is our deacon vice chairman and deacon on call this week, to pray for us this morning. Thanks, brother.
Let's pray. God, we just thank you for the opportunity we have to be here this morning, Lord, to gather in our newly built sanctuary for the second time. And Lord, it's just such a blessing to be where we are and to be in the financial situation that we're in here, Father. And just pray that we continue to move forward with that so we can be debt-free and put more of our money towards missions, Father, and the furthering of your word. Lord, just thank you for the staff we have here at Fort Johnson and the membership and everything you're doing in this community. We pray that we would focus on you, put you first, Father, in our lives, and pray for Marty as he brings the message today. And if there's someone here that does not know you, Lord, as their personal Lord and Savior, we pray that they would put their trust in you, Lord. Thank you for all you've done and everything you will do in our lives. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Derek. Appreciate it. Let's gather or stand and continue to worship together.
He goes by the name running. He goes by the name of Jehovah, Jehovah. Call the name, call the name, call the name, Jehovah. All our praise, all our praise, all our praise belongs to Him.
Sing it out. His foes will be silent.
His foes will be silent. He's fighting for Zion. There's no other God like Jehovah. Jehovah, His eyes never tire. His eyes are like fire. There's no other God like Jehovah. Jehovah, call the name, call the name, call the name. All our praise, all our praise belongs to Him. Call the name, call the name, call the name, Jehovah. All our praise, all our praise, all our praise belongs to Him.
Jehovah Nissi, fight your battles. Jehovah Jireh, meet your need. Jehovah Rapha, heal your body. Jehovah Shalom, be your peace.
Jehovah Nissi, fight your battles. Jehovah Jireh, meet your need. Jehovah Rapha, heal your body. Jehovah Shalom, be your peace. Jehovah Nissi, fight your battles. Jehovah Jireh, meet your need. Jehovah Rapha, heal your body. Jehovah Shalom, be your peace. Call the name. Call the name, call the name, Jehovah. All I pray, all I pray, all I pray belongs to Him. Call the name, call the name, call the name, Jehovah. All I pray, all our praise, all our praise belongs to Him.
Who am I then? But He brought me in. Oh, His love for me. Oh, His love for me. Through the sun sets free. Oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
Free at last, He has ransomed me, His grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me.
Yes, he died for me. Ooh, the sun sets free. Oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. For me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am who you say I am. The sun. Child of God, yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place.
Father God, we just thank you so much for this morning, God, just to be able to be together, just still just so surreal that we are back in this place. But God, we just come here to worship you, God, and just understand that it is so much more than just this building, Lord, that we are a church and a body of people. And God, we just thank you so much that we can come together today to be able to just worship you in this place, Lord. Be with all of us today. God, we ask that this message just fall in our hearts. Please be with Pastor Marty as he shares his message today. In your name, amen. First through third graders are now dismissed to Kid Connection.
There are so many that don't know Jesus in the city of Boston. I lead the Beloved Initiative, which is an anti-trafficking and sexual abuse awareness campaign. My ministry right now looks like reaching our refugee friends and their families, our homeless friends, and also women who are experiencing exploitation. There are so many parts to the equation. We look for, creative ways to, meet needs. I'm really passionate about gifting essential products, but it's the importance of leaving the pews and going out and being the light and love of Jesus. We have volunteers within our churches. We're creating, earrings and bracelets to then use those for our street outreach. We can just bless women that are in strip clubs or on the street. And the goal is just really that the lost will be reached with the love of Christ. When people give to the Annie Armstrong offering, individuals are receiving Christ and realizing their beloved identities as beloved sons and daughters. Your generous support is going towards so many individuals who do not have a relationship with Jesus, helping them realize that they are loved and loved by Christ.
Annie Armstrong was influential, to say the least. She was a woman who spoke up for missions and ministries and missionaries all over. She championed mission support among Southern Baptist churches and cast a grand vision for their growing involvement in praying, giving, and going. Since 1895, what is now called the Annie Armstrong Easter Offering has fueled Southern Baptist churches and their mission work in North America. And In this time, churches and individuals have given every Easter season to help Jesus be made known. What an opportunity. We also get this opportunity this Easter season. So when you give to Annie Armstrong Easter offering, communities in North America with little or no gospel representatives receive aid for new churches to be planted, physical needs to be met, and Jesus to be made known. 100% of your offering that's given towards this goes towards supporting thousands of missionaries serving in church planting and compassion ministries all over North America. This is the opportunity before us this Easter season. So if you'd like to give to the Annie Armstrong Easter offering, there's two ways that you can give. One is you can go online, anniearmstrong.com, and you can do a gift there. If not that, then there is this envelope that's in the back of many of your chairs where you can insert a gift here, and it will go towards the Annie Armstrong offering to make Jesus known in North America. I'm going to pray for us, and Marty will come up and preach from the Word this morning. Father God, thank you for who you are. God, thank you for the many ways that we get to see your goodness, not just internationally, but here in North America as well. God, I pray that through this Easter offering, we would hear about the tangible effects that we're having. God, I pray that you would move mightily during this season. God, move through Pastor Marty as he brings the Word this morning. In your name I pray, Lord. Amen.
It is amazing to see what God does through the Annie Armstrong Easter offering. I tell you what, as I come up here last week was full, so I didn't know where anybody was sitting. But even this week, as I stood up here earlier, I thought, I got used to where people were sitting, you know, with four sections, and that's different now. Some of you have found like the equivalent of where that is, where in the sanctuary. Some of you have found where you were sitting 2.5 years ago and are kind of back in those places. So it's new. So if you see me just kind of staring at you, I'm not trying to be creepy. I'm just trying to figure out where people are sitting and things like that. And that's just good communication, right? Just to make good eye contact, perhaps. But I am so glad. This whole week, I've walked in this room and just stood here and just been like, wow, 2.5 years, we're done, you know, kind of almost done. But it is such an encouragement to be able to come and to use this space. And then as we reset the gym, I mean, it's already being used for ministry. I know on Monday nights we got some basketball. This past week, the students were in there, I believe. And then maybe I'm thinking of somebody else. I know the college students on Friday night, we played some games in there. And I whipped almost one knockout. So close. It was like me from my team and four people from one team. So I beat everybody but that one team, you know, so I feel pretty good about myself. So if you guys want to play some basketball, I'll take all of you and almost, no, I'm just playing, not really. How many of you guys been keeping up with the March Madness, okay, yeah, good. Congrats on all my Clemson fans, yeah, right? Sorry for all my other South Carolina teams. I apologize. I'm rooting Duke still in it. So I'm hoping that we might pull out a championship this year. How many of you filled out a bracket this year? Okay. About five of you. Okay. Good. I know my wife did. She's been watching it every day, you know? And so, did you know, of those who filled out a bracket, how many of you have your brackets busted already? Yeah. Right. I think, did you know that 22 million people created a March Madness bracket on ESPN? Over 22 million people. And out of those 22 million people, guess how many people still have a perfect bracket out of all of those 22 million people? I see a one. You still have a perfect bracket? No, okay. But I actually saw zero. Nobody made it past the first round. That evidently is fairly normal. There actually was a guy in 2019, a guy named Greg Nigel, who kept the bracket. He predicted 49 games correctly, made it all the way to the Sweet 16, and it didn't win any. I don't know if he won anything. I don't know if you do you win anything with brackets, or is it just? I mean, I guess you can if you throw some money on it or something like that. But we don't do that in the Baptist Church, right? But anyway, zero brackets are still perfect after this first round. We can know every stat about every team and have great expectations that our team will make it to the end or at least past the first round. But it can be kind of disappointing when things don't turn out the way that they think that we think they should, or we think that we would like them to. Like, I'll be disappointed when Duke loses, or if Duke loses. Actually, they're not going to lose. They're going all the way. Sorry, Clemson fans. We're going to take you out. Now, I know brackets busting is really not that big a deal, but there are times in our lives, or times in the lives of those people that God has placed you around, where things haven't really turned out like you expected them to, right? Or maybe that you had hoped that they would. And maybe for you it's a job that you thought you would have, all you grew up, you dreamed of being something, and it hasn't really panned out that way. For me, I wanted to work at IBM. So like when I was a kid, my dad worked in like the food services of IBM, and I thought, man, I'm gonna be a computer programmer and just sit at a desk by myself without having to deal with people. Because I'm an introvert, believe it or not, I'm an introvert at heart, and just troubleshoot and program things and that sort of stuff and make people's lives easier because of programming. I actually told God, but that was one dream. Second dream was to be Phantom on Broadway in Phantom of the Opera. But I learned every song in Phantom of the Opera because I thought I'm going to be Phantom, wear the mask. I mean, I'm ugly enough to be Phantom, you know. But I thought that was my dream. And of those two dreams, none of them have worked out. I've been to Broadway, but not to sing at Broadway. I actually told God, because my dad was a youth pastor and music director, and I said, there's no way on God's green earth that I'll ever be in ministry. Never in the world would I have thought I'd be a pastor. This is a surprise to me. And sometimes God works things out in a way very differently than what we had planned. And I don't say I'm disappointed in that. I'm really pleased that I'm doing the things that I'm doing and that God has directed me, because I can't imagine living in New York City with all that's going on there. Or I can't imagine sitting in a cubicle all day long. I think I would go stir crazy because I like to get up and about and out and about. Like, sitting in the office sometimes gets hard. Maybe for you it's marriage. And marriage has been harder than you thought it would be. I just performed a wedding yesterday out at Harborside East, right at the bottom of the bridge in the Mount Pleasant side. And they made their vow to love each other for better, for worse. You guys know sickness and in health, in poverty and in wealth, till death do us part, right? We make those promises. And when I was doing the premarital counseling with these guys over the past couple months, we had conversations about how that loving feeling that they feel right now is probably going to wane at some point. There'll be a time when you might love the person, but you don't like the person. And there are times whenever these vows that you take in sickness and in health, in poverty and in wealth, and for better and for worse, there are some days that are worse, right? We don't see them at the beginning of our marriage, but they do come along. Maybe a spouse gets sick, or you just begin to, your personalities change and you get on each other's nerves. I love how when you're first dating and you're getting ready for marriage, the things that attract you to the person then become the things that annoy you the most about that person. Amy loved the way I used to crunch my chips, and now she hates it. No, I'm just playing. She does hate it. She never liked my crunching, but she does hate it now. But marriage is not easy. There's a reason we make vows, because we promise in sickness and health, better for worse. It's hard. Marriage is difficult. Not only is it difficult, but we have an enemy who is seeking to destroy our marriage because it displays the love, the faithfulness, the commitment of Christ for his people. And so when marriage is hard, like, we turn our eyes not to one another, because that would only make it worse sometimes, but we turn our eyes to Jesus and remember the sacrificial love that he had for us. And we love each other despite who they are sometimes. Thank you, babe, for loving me despite who I am. Maybe for you, you had hoped to make the team, whatever team that is, sports team, basketball. I thought that I might make a basketball. Actually, I never thought I'd make a basketball team. I did want to play football. My dad never let me play football. but I did want to, maybe you want to play a sport, but you didn't make the cut or something, or maybe you played a sport and all your life you played soccer or you played baseball, and all your life you worked your way up and you made it, you even got a college scholarship, and you get to the point of college and you get an injury, and then you get another injury, and eventually, like a guy I saw yesterday at the Palmetto Collective meal, they asked him to step away from the team. Because he was prone to injury. And so the scholarships he lost, the thing that he loved, he thought God had ripped it away from him. But I loved hearing his story and how what he thought was his life and his future. He was devastated, obviously, to begin with. God began to change his perspective and helped him see the opportunities that he now had because he wasn't at practice every single moment of every single day. So sometimes God changes our plans or changes the trajectory of our life because he has something better. And it may be disappointing, it may be discouraging at times, but in those devastating times, he can work even through those. We sometimes think we have life all figured out, right? I don't know about you, but you plan it out and you think, I'm going to do this and I'm going to do that and I'm going to do that and this over here. And when it doesn't go as planned, it can really be hard. But when God has different plans, we can trust that his plans are really what needs to happen. So as we celebrate Palm Sunday, we look back on the very first Palm Sunday, that 6 or 7 days before Jesus was crucified on a cross for the forgiveness of our sins. On that first Palm Sunday, there were people who had great expectations. They thought they knew what was going to happen, only to discover that Jesus was not the Messiah that they thought he would be, not the Messiah that they had originally envisioned. So as we dive in and look at that first Palm Sunday, look with me at John chapter 12. If you don't have a Bible, there in the seat, under the seats in front of you perhaps, there might be a Bible there. If you don't have one at all at home, feel free to take that one as our gift to you. But go ahead and turn in your Bibles to John chapter 12, or you can flip them on in your phone or iPad or whatever. But John chapter 12 is where we're going to be. Looking at this Palm Sunday, this triumphal entry as Jesus is walking into the city of Jerusalem. We'll start at verse 12 and walk through to verse 26. When you're there, say there. Yeah, you got most of you. Follow along. Here we go. You read as I read out loud. John 12, verse 12. The next day, the large crowd that had come to the feast heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. So they took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him, crying out, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, even the King of Israel. And Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it, just as it was written, Fear not, daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt. His disciples did not understand these things at first, but when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things had been written about him and had been done to him. The crowd that had been with him when he called Lazarus out of the tomb and raised him from the dead continued to bear witness. So picture this. As he's walking in the city, just a few moments before, a couple days before, he had been with Mary and Martha, who had just lost their brother Lazarus, and Jesus comes up, wept because Lazarus was the friend, and raised him from the dead. So everybody's thinking, here is a man who can raise people from the dead. We're following him. We've seen him do some miracles. We've seen him make blind people see and lame people walk, but he just raised Lazarus from the dead. Lazarus, who was clearly dead, as the King James Version says, he stinketh. So he was definitely dead. Jesus raised him from the dead. And so everybody's super stoked that he's coming into town. They're thinking, here's the Messiah we've been waiting for, and they're following him. So let's keep going, verse 18. The reason why the crowd went to meet him was that they heard he had done this sign. So the Pharisees said to one another, you see that you are gaining nothing. Look, the world has gone after him. I mean, everybody's in an uproar. This huge crowd of people are around the street as Jesus is coming into Jerusalem. Verse 20, now among those who went up to worship at the feast were some Greeks or Gentiles. So these came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and asked him, Sir, we wish to see Jesus. Philip went and told Andrew. Andrew and Philip then went and told Jesus, and Jesus answered them, saying this, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. That piqued their ears. They're like, what? The Son of Man? They knew this language. This was the Messiah. He's going to be glorified? What? Really? And so they're getting excited. Verse 24, truly, truly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Whoever loves his life loses it, and whoever hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. If anyone serves me, he must follow me. And where I am, there will be my servant also. If anyone serves me, the Father will honor him. Let's ask God's blessing. I know we pray a lot. I figured God's the one who wrote this book. He can help us understand it as we go through. Let's pray. God, thank you again for your word. Thank you for this, the recording of this event that we can learn from it today. God, help us to see what you would have to say to us individually, Lord, and us as a church. Lord, speak to our hearts, we ask. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So on December 4th, 1977, this was the year before I was born, in Bangui capital, which was the capital of Central African Empire, the world press was witnessing the coronation of the Imperial Majesty Bokassa I. Does anybody know who Bokassa I is? Did anybody see this coronation? Good. So if I mess up the facts, I'm not going to have questions afterwards. Good deal. I'm not making this up. This is a real event, but I thought, well, if I mess it up, I want to know who to talk to get it straight. The price tag for that coronation in 1977, which was, I'm 46 years old, 46 years ago, 47 years ago. So inflation was even less. They, in that year, the price tag for this event, this coronation, which was choreographed by French designer Olivier Bryce, was $25 million. That's a lot of money. At 10:10 in the morning, the blare of trumpets, the roll of drums announced the approach of His Majesty Bokassa. Everybody say Bokassa. Good. I'm just making sure everybody's awake. Good stuff. The procession began, listen, with 8 of Bokassa's 29 official children. I'm wondering if there are unofficial children. Parading down the royal carpet to their seats, they were followed by Jean Bedel Bokassa II, who was heir to the throne. He was dressed in this white admiral's outfit, and he came and he sat down on a red pillow to the left of the throne. This is the left. To the left of the throne. Following them was Catherine, the favorite of Bokassa's 9 wives. Lord bless his soul. She was wearing a $73,000 gown made by Lanvin in Paris. $73,000 gown. I'm like, that's a lot of money. I hate to spend. Anyway, it was strewn with pearls that she had handpicked to be on this dress. The emperor had arrived in a golden 8 bedecked imperial coach drawn by 6 matching horses, fancy horses. He wore a 32-pound robe with 785,000 strewn pearls and gold embroidery. I mean, this guy was majestic. I mean, like Elvis times 100, right? You know, he got the white outfit and the gold and the pearls. On his brow, he wore a gold crown of laurel leaves, like those worn by the Roman consuls of old, symbolizing the favor of the gods. So he's like God's chosen man for this place right here. And as the sacred march came to a conclusion, Bokassa sat himself on a $2.5 million throne, took off his golden laurel wreath, and then put on a $2.5 million crown, which was topped with an 80-carat diamond, and placed on his head. That's pretty big deal that he's walking to this city. Kind of reminds me of, you guys have seen Aladdin, right? When Aladdin, this big old parade comes into the town. The Israelites had heard that one day God would send a Messiah, a Savior, the King of Israel. And when they begin to hear and see what Jesus was doing, they're thinking, this is the guy. And they knew he was going to ride in because of prophecies that had been told before. He was going to ride into Jerusalem and become the king. In their mind, they were picturing something like Bokassa. white, gold, pearls, beautiful, everything. Probably not 9 wives or 8 or 29 children. But they knew that he would come in with great power. They thought he was going to come in and take out the Roman Empire. They fully expected that Jesus would issue a call to arms and drive out the Romans, which they hated. They thought they were having a military leader going to come over and conquer the land. So in their mind, they're thinking huge white horses leading the way, robes and gold and all the entourage coming alongside him. And when Jesus comes in on a donkey, I can imagine they were curious, wondering what in the world is going on here. Jesus, however, was a new kind of king. He rode in on this colt of a donkey. It was a royal entrance, but not nearly the pomp and circumstance of a great king. The donkey was a humble animal, representing the peace that Jesus would bring. Now, in that crowd, as we read, there were Jewish people as well as Gentiles or Greeks, many of which wanted to meet Jesus. I mean, if you think the King of Israel, the Messiah, is rolling into town, everybody wants to meet him. Everybody wants to kind of shake hands. Kind of like, you know, when your boss comes in, if you want to work your way up the corporate ladder, you schmooze a little bit, you know. You go in, you say how nice his outfit looks that day, you know. Man, you're really doing things great around here, so that he begins to think highly of you and maybe puts you into a place of power as well. So here are Jewish people, here are Greek people who are coming in. They want to meet with Jesus because they think, here is the Messiah, he's going to conquer the world, and I want a piece of the action. They want to get in. They thought he was going to throw down, and they want a piece of the action and some of the power that comes along with it. But Jesus turned their expectations upside down. There in verse 24 through 26, look with me again. It says, truly, truly, I say to you, this is Jesus, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Whoever loves his life loses it, and whoever hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. If anyone serves me, he must follow me. And where I am, there my servant will be also. If anyone serves me, the Father will honor him. So they're thinking, okay, well, if God will honor me, I'll follow him. Now, if you look at that, they begin to understand what he was saying there. They really begin to understand it days down the road. Jesus was referring to his coming death and the fruit that will be born from his sacrifice. And maybe they didn't quite understand it then, but they certainly were going to understand it in a few moments. And soon enough, when they see Jesus die on a cross, Jesus redefines the method of accomplishing the mission of conquering the world, or doing what he, restoring the world. Instead of raising an army, he would lay down his life to accomplish the mission that God had sent them for there. Now, this was not what the crowd had bargained for. This was not the plan that they had in mind. They thought he was going to come in with a sword and take out the Roman people. He was coming in to lay down his life as a humble servant. Even over the next few days, he begins to serve his disciples and wash their feet at the Last Supper. The people responded in different ways. They wanted the right hand of God, and they didn't really want to give up their life. But Jesus was calling them to do that very thing. The people responded in different ways. Some continued to follow him, willing to give up their plans, willing to give up their lives, their thoughts, their hopes, and their dreams to live for Jesus, to follow him and do what he said to do. They didn't know what that was at the time. Little did they know that it meant that he was going to be going to a cross and they would have to follow him to that kind of sacrifice. But then you got some there who didn't believe him at all. Verse 37 says, even though they had seen a man raised from the dead, they thought, that's just some magic or something like that. And so they didn't listen, they didn't follow, they didn't believe that he was who he said he was. And then you've got some who later on that week who were laying palm branches at his feet to begin with at the beginning of the week and singing praises to his name because they thought that they were going to get something out of that. They thought they were going to get the freedom from the Roman Empire. Later on down the week, they were the ones who were yelling, crucify him, crucify him. Because they realize this isn't the Messiah that they thought that they would have. So I encourage you, as we go through this next week, as we think towards the crucifixion, the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus, take some time to read over the rest of John. to get to know this whole story. Maybe it's become familiar. Maybe you've grown up in church and you're like, oh, I know that story. I would encourage you, take some time to read over it again. Maybe if you need a plan tomorrow, read chapter 13 and 14 of John. And then chapter 15 the next day, 16 the next day, 17 the next day. It will end on Sunday morning before you come to church, reading chapter 20, talking about the resurrection. So do two chapters tomorrow and then one chapter every week, every day after that, to get to know this story, to prepare your heart for what Jesus did for us on that Easter Sunday. When things don't go the way that you think they should, think about it. When things don't go the way that you think they should, and I would imagine every one of us in here has had a time when things didn't go the way that they should. How do you respond? Do you freak out? Turn to your own way and try to figure it out on your own? Maybe at the last minute, man, I've tried everything else, I guess we'll just go and pray. God will work on it then. Or do you really trust the Lord, knowing that maybe he has something different than what you had in mind? Instead of freaking out, let's show the world that we do trust in a God who actually is sovereign. He knows what he's doing. And follow him. That means following his commands. That means living as he lived, doing the things that he did, focusing in on the things that he would focus on, having the same affections that he had. As we walk with him, as we live with him, as we follow him, we see greater things in store. When we look around at our circumstances, we may wonder, what in the world is God doing? Does he even have a clue? I mean, you're the God of the universe. Why are you taking me through this mess right here? But when we trust him to do what is best, we don't have to worry. He proves himself faithful again and again and again. And so many times we go through the same situations and we freak out because we don't remember him being faithful the time before. Jesus said that those who serve him will follow him. Paul, the apostle, wrote to the Corinthian church, and in his letter he said this, and Jesus died for all, that those who live will no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. So Jesus, the purpose he came to die was so that we who follow him would not live for ourselves, but would live for him. Because as we live for him, it begins to shape and mold our heart. We follow him. We do the things that he did. And the world around us sees a picture of who Jesus is. When we follow Jesus, we die to ourselves. When we follow Jesus, we put away our desires. We put away our hopes and our dreams, perhaps. And we follow what he would have for us. Now, you're thinking, well, I want to be this and I want to be that. I mean, the scriptures are clear. We delight yourself in the Lord and he'll give you the desires of your heart. As we delight ourselves in the Lord, he's still going to give us gifts to do the things perhaps that he's called us to do, but we're going to be on mission for him through those things. Maybe you want to be a physical therapist. God can use you as a physical therapist to bring glory to his name. Maybe you want to clean houses and own companies. Maybe you want to be a coach or a teacher. Continue to use those gifts that God has given you, but use them for, leverage them for his kingdom. The relationships that you build are for his kingdom and his glory. So let me ask you this. When he says die to yourself and live for him, what does that mean for you and the circumstances that you're in right now? I started to think through examples. I thought, you know, I don't know everybody's circumstances, but when you think about what does it mean to die to yourself and to live for Jesus, what are the things that are keeping you from living completely for him? What does it mean in your life to die to yourself and to live for Jesus? Now, you can't do this on your own, obviously. When you give your lives to Christ, his spirit begins to work in us to accomplish the things through us. So as we follow him, he begins to work in us and through us. And I love what this last section of this chapter, or the last section that we just read, says. Look at verse 26 with me. It says, if anyone serves me, the Father will honor him. If anyone serves me, if anyone begins to follow me, because he says, if you serve me, you will follow me, just above that. If anyone serves me, the Father will honor him. as we follow Jesus, as we serve Jesus, the Father will honor, he'll lift up, he'll sustain you. He's not going to let you out of his hand. He's going to hold you and get you through the circumstances that you're in right now. The Father will honor you as you serve him, as you live for him. So maybe today you've realized that you've heard all your life about Jesus. Maybe you even know a lot of stories about Jesus, but you're still living for yourself. You're still living the dream that you have for yourself, and you haven't really even considered what God would call you to do. Maybe today is the day that you're like, hey, I'm going to stop living for myself, and I'm going to begin to live for Jesus, and I'm going to follow Jesus. I'm going to walk with him. I'm going to read his word. I'm going to spend some time with him and allow him to work in us and through us. Maybe you know a lot about Jesus, but you've never really known Jesus. Maybe today is the day that you give your life to Jesus and say, I want to stop living for myself and live for you. Or maybe today, actually before I do that, I want to invite you, if that's you, I want to invite you to follow Jesus today. Our whole purpose here at Fort Johnson Baptist Church is helping people find Jesus, but also helping people follow Jesus. We want to walk alongside you. We will do everything. When you begin to follow Jesus, he'll do the rest. You accept his invitation, and you begin to live for him, and he'll do the rest through this body. That's why he calls us the body of Christ. We come alongside one another to help one another live for Jesus and not for ourselves. Does that make sense? That's why it's important that we consistently come together so we know one another well, we have these relationships, and we can encourage one another towards faith and good works. That's what the body is for. When things are hard, when things are difficult, we can encourage one another to continue to focus on Jesus and what he's done for us. That's why we have what we have here. Maybe today there's an area in your life that you're holding on to. Maybe you need to let it go. Maybe your plans are not what you thought they would be. And you need to release the expectations that you have on your life and ask the Lord, what would you have me do? Like the guy I met yesterday, he was like, I'm not sure what I'm going to do now that I can't play baseball. But the Lord, he literally asked the Lord, prayed, Lord, what would you have me do? And he has opened up door after door after door to be able to minister, to be able to serve other people, to be able to be successful in the things that he's doing at school as well. You don't have to do it all alone. Again, that's what the family of faith is for, to come alongside and encourage one another to walk in obedience. So if that's you and you're like, I need to give something up to be able to not distract me from Jesus, I want to live completely for him, and you want to share that with somebody, I invite you to do that. We'll be down here in the front here in just a few minutes. You can come to the altar. You can pray and just ask God, what do you want me to do? I want to live for you. What do you want me to do? Somebody will come alongside and pray with you as well. Maybe life's thrown you a curveball and you're not really sure what to do, and you just want to pray, someone to pray with you. Like, what, God, I don't know what to do. What am I supposed to do with this situation? As we go into this next song, I invite you to come and let's pray together on what God would have us do individually. But listen, what would God have us do as a church? I don't know about you, but over the past 2 years, I've dreamed this and that and the other, and I'm thinking, man, it'd be great if this happened, or it'd be great if that happened. But over the past few weeks, I've been thinking, well, maybe what would God have us do? And maybe you want to join me in praying for what this church will do in this community, and God will give wisdom and direction there. So as we sing this last song, I'm going to pray here in just a minute. We're going to sing a song. I want to invite you to come. If you want to give your life to Christ, I'd love to chat with you. Corey would love to chat with you. If you just want to come and pray at the altar, you can do that as well. Someone will come and pray with you. So let me pray for us, and then we'll sing and respond together. Father, thank you for your word. I thank you for the Israelites and the Greeks and the example that we saw here in this passage. Father, for those who, when things didn't go what they thought they would, they continued to follow you. Lord, even for the example that we see in those who didn't believe, Lord, we know now what not to do. We see that following you leads to life. God, I pray for those who are here this morning that don't know you, Lord, that your spirit will work in their heart to draw them to you, to help them see their need for you, and the not just the good things that come from it, but Lord, the hope that they have to be able to make it through each and every day. Father, I pray that as we seek and follow after you, that you will begin to use us to impact the community here on James Island, the people that we work with alongside, well, the people even in our home as we try to raise our children to know and to love you. God, I pray that you will help us not to worry, to trust in you as we know that you are faithful to take care of our needs. So, Father, I pray as we sing this song, as we respond, I pray that you'll continue to work in our hearts to draw us near to you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Whatever you sense the Lord calling you to do this morning, don't just do nothing. Maybe you want to pray there in your seat, that's fine, but I think there's something about getting up and moving. One, it helps other people know I'm not alone in this struggle. We don't feel like we all have it to have it together. But it also shows that, hey, we're here for one another. And that's if somebody sees that you need prayer and we can pray with one another, God will use that connection that we have to be able to honor him and please him. So respond to him during this last song. Or maybe you're like, I ain't coming down front, and you just want to write something on that connect card, and we'll follow up with you this week. And you put that in the offering box as you leave, and we'll follow up with you. But let's stand, let's lift our voices, and let's respond to the Lord during this song.
And are you hurting and broken within, and overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. And have you come to the end of yourself? And do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. And oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. And oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Savior, isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. Bow down before him, for he is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. And oh, what a Savior. Sing hallelujah.
blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Are you hurting and broken within, and overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. And have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling.
Sunday, where we get to look to the story of Jesus, the narrative of Jesus, where he's come and he enters into Jerusalem as a triumphant king, and then he navigates to what will become of his death and then resurrection on Easter Sunday. As we look to this story, I want to read for you one of my favorite texts that I think does a great job of summarizing just this. This is Philippians 2. It says, have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Palm Sunday leads to Easter resurrection. This is good news. This is the greatest story ever told. And we're meant as ambassadors of Christ, as a community of faith, as a family of faith, I send you out this morning, man, my challenge to you is that you'd invite someone to Easter. You'd have a lunch with someone who you don't know. You'd invite someone into your life so that they can too hear the greatest story ever told. For Johnson family, as a light to our community, you are sent.